right. Hello. Awesome. Well, hi, everyone. Thank you guys so much for being here. It's so awesome to see all of your beautiful faces. Thank you for being a part of our panel discussion for CBN's latest campaign called Unhooked, Holy in a Hookup World. Well, we're just going to get real, y'all. We're talking about sex. We're talking about dating. We're talking about relationships and love as a single Christian in today's kind of crazy hookup culture. As you can see, we have an amazing panel. Come on, let's give them a pre-round of applause, y'all. Please allow me to take a moment to introduce them to you all. So first up, we have Mo Isom Aiken, who is speaker and author of Wreck My Life and Sex, Jesus, and the Conversations the Church Forgot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
right? Next, we have Alec Bevere, who is a director and co-founder of Sons and Daughters TV. And I might add, the last single son of Lisa and John Bevere. That's right.
What are you doing?
Yeah. And then we have Jamal Miller, who is co-founder of marriedandyoung.com and also the author of 25 Ways to Prepare for Dating Other Than Marriage. Can I get an amen, people? And last but certainly not least, we have Arlene Spenceley, who is a speaker and author of Chastity is for Lovers, Single, Happy, and Still a Virgin. Let's go. So before we get started with our questions, we have a short video we want you guys to watch that's really just gonna break the ice and set the mood for a conversation. So take a look.
Okay, guys, if you need anything else, just let me know.
Thank you. Ooh,
thanks. Yep. You look great, honey.
You do, and we missed you.
I know, I've missed you guys too. I'm sorry, I've just been like so busy with work and everything.
We know that.
And I've kind of been going through some things too. That's why I asked you both here tonight. It's kind of awkward to talk about with your parents, so just give me.
You know anything about this?
I feel like I keep putting myself in this continuous cycle and it just needs to stop. So that's why I've decided to go on an intimacy fast.
What is that?
Intimacy, so like taking a break from.
Yeah, I mean stopping like altogether.
Oh, wait a minute, time out. What do you mean stopping? When did you start?
Like prom a couple years ago? That's the point. The bottom line is, I feel like I'm being used by these guys.
Oh my gosh.
Really? Honey, did you say guys with an S?
Yeah.
Honey, listen, we need to be cool right now.
Okay.
Our daughter's trying to talk to us.
Oh, I understand that. I just want to make sure that she meant to make it plural, honey. I mean, there's a big difference between guys and guys.
Okay. Dad, you know I talk to guys and hang out with them on a regular basis.
Here we go with the guys thing again. Whatever happened to, what's his name? What's his name? Pete. That's it. What happened to Pete?
Are you serious?
Yeah,
you
I like
Pete. Why are
no,
you
no, no,
bringing
that's not
him
true.
Up right now? You hated him.
Lily, it's obvious your dad is just having a hard time adjusting to you as, you know, a grown woman.
Thank you. I am grown.
She's grown.
She's still on our car insurance.
Really? So, you're going to hold that against me?
Hey, you're in good hands, honey.
You offered that, and it was your idea.
Prom was your mom's idea.
Hey. Oh, my gosh.
Lily, when you say intimacy, I am going to have to ask what you mean by that. I mean, is it a little? Is it a lot?
I mean, it's just one after the other, and I feel like I can't catch a break. Dad, what's up? I mean, do you think this is a good idea? What are you thinking?
What am I thinking? Hey, is this a good idea? What are you thinking, honey? I mean, seriously, guys with an S, you can't catch a break? I mean, are you even using protection?
Protection?
Yes.
It's important. I need protection. What are you talking about? Like,
tell you better.
I thought you didn't spray. No. How about trying a raincoat? You know what I mean?
A raincoat?
Yeah,
why would I need a rain?
Seriously?
Oh my gosh. Okay. Do you guys think that I'm talking about sex?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
What is it, Lily? What is it? What?
Hi.
Sir, I'm gonna need you to keep it down. Just a touch.
Do you enjoy breathing, son?
Honey.
Yes, sir.
Oh my gosh.
It might be time to leave.
Oh my gosh.
Give him a second.
No,
give him a second.
He's
a guy. Okay, and your father and I, we put two and two together.
And you said these guys with an S can't catch a break.
I mean, what else could it be, Lily?
Oh my gosh, that's not what I'm talking about.
What do you mean? Not sex?
No. I'm talking about taking a break from dating, not sex.
Wait a minute. So you are not being physically intimate with young men your age?
Okay, the way you worded that was really weird.
Really weird.
No, I am not having sex with people. You could have just said that.
Oh, well, in that case, let's get that nice waiter back over here.
Excuse me, everyone. Drinks are on me.
Lily, what is the real reason that you decided to go on this intimacy fast?
Honestly, it's a God thing. I mean, I feel like if I can trust him with my soul, why can't I trust him with my heart?
I can't tell you how proud of
We're
you
so proud.
Your mom and I are.
We're so proud of you. Oh, I mean, just look at you. You're glowing.
Why would you say that? She's not glowing.
Well, not in that way.
You know what? I really think your dad and I should go on an intimacy fast.
You should.
Don't you think?
No.
Yeah,
I do.
Mind your business. No, ma'am. You've had enough.
I'm getting the check.
She's fine.
Stay.
We're
going to do it.
No, ma'am.
Well, to give you guys a little bit of background, that skit is actually based on my own personal journey and testimony of deciding to go on a year-long intimacy fast. That's right, no dating, no flirting, no relationships, no physical intimacy for a whole year. And to give you guys a little bit more background, as I said in the skit, I was just tired of it all. I was continuously putting myself in a cycle of just dating to date. You know, great guys, but deep down I knew that it's not what the Lord wanted for me at the time, and it wasn't going to work out, and I was just dating to date and expecting God to just plop my husband down right in front of me. But it wasn't until I actually read Mo Isom's first book, Wreck My Life, where I really felt the Lord call me to give him a year of my life where there was no relationships, no dating, no intimacy, just really soaking in his presence and soaking in this season of singleness that he purposefully placed me in. Relationships was something that I really had to surrender to the Lord. It was something that I was trying to control and hang on to. But I really had to come to a point in my life where I just really had to trust God. I had to trust God with relationships. And I really had to come to a point where I needed to be content. But most of all, I needed to be content enough to know and believe and stand firm in the fact that Christ is enough for me, regardless of my marital status. So that's why we're here tonight, y'all. That's why we encourage you guys to come out, because we want to encourage you to take a 40-day intimacy fast. Not a year, so don't get scared, just 40 days. And we have an amazing devotional ready for you guys to sign up and take tonight. If you pull out your phones, you can go to cbn.com/unhooked to sign up for that, because we want you guys to really just be transformed and renewed in your mind. And I look forward to what God is going to do in the season of singleness in your life. But not only will you get a devotional every day for 40 days, you'll actually get this awesome companion journal to follow along in. It's got day one, day two, all the way to day 40. Now that the stage is set, the ice is broken, who's ready for some tough questions? Anyone? All right. Okay. So the first question goes to the lovely woman of God, Mo Isom Aiken. As I mentioned, I read your book, Wreck My Life, where you talked about taking a year off of dating. And if you could just give our audience a little bit of background into how the Lord led you to that and what it did for you.
Yeah. You know, I had grown up churched. I'd grown up knowing a lot about God, but didn't truly know God. And it was through a lot of adversity and a lot of life circumstances and a lot of depression and anxiety and promiscuity and seeking wholeness and seeking belonging in all the wrong places for a long time that ultimately set the stage for God really just interrupting my life in a really powerful way and revealing to me who he was. And when I came to place my faith in Jesus, he just started to, the cry of my heart really was like, I don't want this comfortable Christianity anymore. I don't want to just know a lot about you. I want to know you. And I want you to wreck my life. And I want you to redefine my life. And so I want you to dismantle anything in me that needs dismantling. And one of the very first things he really brought to the surface for me was sexuality, was my identity as a woman, was all things relationship. And I was like, that's not actually, Lord, what I first wanted. So if we could do some other work. And he was like, no, no, no. And he brought it all to the surface because it was a struggle for me. I had struggled a lot with promiscuity, kind of waving that vain virgin banner, but like pushing the envelope as far as we possibly could behind the scenes, hearing the church with the rule list of don't do this, don't do that, and caring about like behavior modification, but never getting heart transformation.
Yeah.
So when I said, God, I really want you, I don't want to just believe in you. I want you to be Lord, Lord of my life. And he was like, give me all of you so that I can pour out all of me into you. Give me a year. And I was like, what about a month? And he was like, give me a year. And what it looked like for me was a monogamous relationship with God. Therefore, I treated everybody else as if I was in a committed monogamous relationship. I didn't date. I didn't flirt. I wasn't physical. It was just a season of stepping away. And I think what's beautiful about fasting ultimately is that it shifts the focus off of us and onto him. And that's how it should be. We're creatures made in his image, made to worship him. And we've got to begin to marry our sexuality, our relationships, our identity into that mold. So yeah, I don't think I'd ever heard of somebody using the term intimacy fast. I thought it was quite brilliant. Wow. I called it kissless till next Christmas. And
yes.
I blogged it.
Oh.
And I was
Mine didn't have a cute name like that.
Yeah, no, it was brilliant marketing, but literally no one joined the movement. So it was just me. But I persevered and it was cool.
I love that. Well, Jamal, this one goes to you. You have marriedandyoung.com with you and your wife. And then you guys also have the One University. Mm-hmm. And I know that you also encourage singles to give God a year of their life. Kind of talk about that. And why do you think it's so important for especially single people to really get right with their intimacy with God before moving into intimate relationships with other people?
Absolutely. And it's so cool for Mo hearing her journey, her story, because it's like God must really love this year concept, right?
Mm-hmm.
For me, I fell in love with love before I fell in love with God. And I was so excited at the thought of being in a relationship. I remember the beginning, high school and college years, just dating around and consistently going from relationship to relationship. Yep. And I remember being in a situationship, right? Me and a young lady, it was one of those where we were just off and on, you know? It was just like, you know, we cool. And so one night we were alone together, and just by the grace of God, in this moment, I was still a virgin. And I just had this thing in my spirit. I was like, man, tonight is tonight. And as things begin to progress, use your imagination, everything stops. And I'm like, I just literally see myself on my wedding day. And I hear the Lord say, if you compromise now, you'll compromise for the rest of your life. And this, I mean, conviction just gripped me.
Mm.
And I looked at her and I said, hey, we can't do this. And so she leaves. And, you know, there's no pastor, there's no violin, piano playing. I mean, it's just straight, you know what I'm saying, in my bedroom. Like, God, I don't even know if you're real, but I just need right now for you to show me who you are. And I remember God just, like, his love just came and just, like, I mean, for the first time I felt his love, like, the real love of God. And I felt that same word from the Lord, Jamal, give me a year. I want you to be focused on me. For an entire year, no dating, no looking. I want you to give me everything, because if you can't commit to me, how are you going to commit to a woman?
Yeah. Mm. Amen.
That's good.
And it was almost a place where God was challenging me. And I was like, oh, God, you're calling me out. I can commit to you. What's up? And I said, okay, God, I'm going to give you a year. And y'all, from that year, I am, by the grace of God, I was able to marry my wife, a virgin. And I was able to experience the most amazing moment with her.
Wow.
Because I fell in love with him, which made it to where I couldn't fall in love with anybody else that didn't have him.
Yeah.
And that's what that year did for me. It solidified that God, you are my number one, and no one else will ever have this place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's powerful. Well, Arlene, we got a question for you, girlfriend. You ready?
All right. Yeah.
Okay, so I feel like a lot of people in the church, especially and even outside of the church, are afraid of intimacy in the form of a committed relationship. However, they're okay with intimacy in the form of physical intimacy and doing probably the most intimate thing you can do with someone, which is have sex with them. Why do you think hooking up is the norm today?
Yeah, hooking up really is the norm. You know, as Ashley mentioned, the subtitle of my book is Single, Happy, and Still a Virgin. And as I was in the stage that I imagine many of you are in, college age, I started to realize very quickly that the lifestyle that I had been living was very unlike the lifestyle of the young adults that surrounded me. And we were always taught, save sex for marriage. That was the message, save sex for marriage. But that was where the message ended.
Yeah.
It was as though people who were older than we were and wiser than we were only wanted to build a wall between us and sex. And the problem that that caused was that kids were told, save sex, but they were never told what sex is. And so according to the media, a lot of times sex is sort of defined as a thing you do to figure out whether you have chemistry with someone, or a thing you do to have fun with the person that you're dating. And so as we get older, we start thinking critically, and we're like, who in their right mind waits until marriage to figure out if you have chemistry with this person, or who in their right mind waits until marriage to have fun with this person? And the answer is no one. And so if you aren't given the correct definition of sex, a lot of times people realize there's no reason for me to wait because they don't know what it is. You know, as whenever I speak to an audience of youth or young adults or parents of teens and tweens, I define sex, and I define it this way. It is a sacred physical sign of the vows that a husband and wife made on the altar where they were married. It is an expression of the unity that is achieved by marriage, which implies that sex is not for single people. And if we know that and we grow up with that knowledge, it makes a lot more sense to wait.
Alec, yeah. Do you think that Christians specifically over-spiritualize the process of dating and marriage? And if so, why do we do that?
Do Christians over-spiritualize dating?
Yeah.
No. No, I mean, you guys laugh because absolutely we do. I mean, I do too. I mean, we all do it. But, I mean, why? You said, why do we do it?
Mm-hmm.
So, in scriptures, it says that eternity is written on our hearts. And I think that that's such an amazing scripture, but I think there's a lot of other things written on our hearts. If you think about it, before the fall ever even happened, there was a problem. Does anybody know what that problem was? Man was alone. Wow, okay, someone's been reading the word.
You get a slice.
Come on, yeah, let's go. Yeah, so man was alone. So the very first problem before there was even a fall was man was alone. That we are beings that are made for companionship, that we are beings that are made to be with someone else. So yeah, we can easily take ourselves to this area that we over-spiritualize it because we're so excited about the person that the Bible talks about, that one can set flight to thousands, but two can send flight to 10,000s, you know, in that two are better than one and that it is better for two to be together. So yes, I would say that we definitely over-spiritualize things, but I forgive you.
Yes.
Please
yes,
forgive
forgiveness.
Me. Yes.
Yes. Good answer. Okay, Mo, we need to talk about boundaries.
Yeah.
How far is too far?
Uh-oh.
Oh. Mm.
Girl, you asked the right person. Okay.
How far is too far? I mean, I feel like that's a legitimate question many of us face once we are in a committed relationship with someone. I mean, is kissing okay? Because there are some people who don't kiss until the altar. Mm-hmm. What is your advice on all of that?
So I'm going to be the voice up here that no one likes through the night, and that's fine with me. Because I am the over-spiritualizer, but truly...
We just talked about that.
I know. We'll hash it out later. I think it's the wrong question. I think it's the wrong question because this is what I grew up with. Like I was mentioning earlier, I grew up with do this, don't do that. I knew a lot about virginity, but no one talked to me about purity. Mm. And the word speaks far more about purity than it ever does about virginity. And I think God cares far more about the condition of our hearts than he does about our behaviors, because at the core, pure behaviors flow from a pure heart, impure behaviors flow from an impure heart. Mm. And so when our question is how far is too far, it's what led me about 2 centimeters from the final act, but still proclaiming I was a good Christian virgin and half of my college laughing in the background because they knew the reputation I carried. Mm. I get passionate about this because it was what I really think led me down just a complete path of ignorance. And ultimately, we love a lot of things. We toss around love, and we toss it around in our dating relationships so flippantly. And ultimately, the only model of love, the steadfast, unchanging, true model of love is self-sacrifice. It's the cross of Christ. And so we say we love our boyfriend or girlfriend, and that's why we're having sex with them. But Paul would actually say that if we're leading another into sin, then we don't even love Christ. Mm. If we're causing our brother or sister to stumble, then we don't even love Christ. And I just think if we truly want to become a generation that's set free from this hookup culture, our question has to shift.
I want to add to, I know for me and my wife, we were long distance, and you can just imagine, right? Talking every day on the phone, texting, it's just building, yeah. Right? And then we see each other. I mean, we dated for about a year before I proposed. And so we saw each other about four times over the course of that year, because I was in Chicago, she was in California.
Wow.
And so when we would come together, I mean, you better believe we had made a decision in the very beginning that, hey, she had never been kissed before. And I looked her in her face and I said, hey, I want to respect you. Mm-hmm. And I want to prove to you, like Christ proved to us when he died on the cross for our sins. He didn't just say, I love you. He proved it by sacrificing himself.
Wow.
With his actions.
And I said, I want to prove to you my love for you by showing you that I'm going to respect you by not, you know, crossing your boundary.
Wow.
And that's what I always say in a relationship. Both of you have to have that conviction, because you're going to, as you're getting to know each other, as you're growing, as you're learning, you're going through the process, y'all, of falling in love. And the natural next step that God created for us is to get married and enjoy the intimacy that has been brewing between two people. That is the power of love. But the reality is we have to demonstrate self-control.
Yeah.
Because sex is just like fire. The moment it breaks outside of the confinement it was created for safety, it now goes from a place of being in joy to now being dangerous.
Yeah.
And so when you see sex and not being able to control it, what do you think you're gonna, you can't control it when you're single? You think it's gonna, you're gonna just immediately know how to control it when you're married?
Yeah.
Because who makes you think that your spouse, the last person you're gonna be attracted to? Hello, wake up. You have a flesh. So if you can't learn how to control yourself with one person and you think you're going to immediately now have one person and just know how to do it with that one person and that's it, you need to know how to practice it before you even get married.
Yeah.
And that's the power of self-control, which why Christ says you can only do this without me. You can't do it without me. Self-control is a fruit of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so I learned this and I was like, okay, God, I need your help, because this is not just a fight to be able to say we did it. Mm-hmm. This is a fight to prove to her that I'm the man that can lead her.
Yeah, that's good.
And I'm
that's
getting good. Her respect before I even get on one knee.
Yeah, right. Yeah, Mo. Yeah. I thought this was, me and Jamal should have sat next to each other. I thought this was a...
Sorry, get over it.
This was a fire line God gave me one time.
Okay.
He said, any boy can undress you and make you feel like a queen for a night. It takes a man to help armor you up and point you to the king of your life.
Oh, what?
Yeah. White.
Let's go.
White.
Whoa.
Yes.
Write that down.
Yes. But it ties into what Jamal's saying. I thought it was powerful.
That's so good.
Everything I just said, that was it, right?
Yeah. Yes. Well, Jamal, my next question was actually going to be to you, because I know, you know, you expressed that you and your wife stayed pure and were virgins until you got married. But a lot of people, when you tell somebody that you're waiting to have sex until marriage, they're like, I don't know how you do that. I can't do that. We have this magical connection. And a lot of people truly believe that you have to have sex with someone before marriage, because you have to make sure that you're sexually compatible. What do you say to people who say that?
If you're getting married just for sex, please do not get married. Mm-hmm. Sex is a gift from God. And it being a gift from God, you have to have the right context of what sex is for. It is for servanthood. Mm-hmm. And what our culture has done, we've made sex, because of the explosion of social media, the explosion of pornography, the explosion of sexual morality, what we're seeing is this selfish just acceleration of me, me, me. Mm-hmm. And so what we find, because of this desire of being sexually compatible, it's already a fixated understanding or thinking that sex is about you. Sex is not about you. Sex is the opportunity for you and a significant other, a person that you love, a person that you care about. The one thing that God says you can't do with anybody else. You can hug a person, You can hang out with a person. You can conversate with a person. But he created one thing for you and your spouse to share, and that is sex. And for you to sit around and allow anybody to have access to that is degrading his gift. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to this thing of sexual compatibility, sex gets better over time. Let me tell y'all, man, it gets better over time. All right? Y'all may hear, what do you mean by that? Right? Look, I got an amen over here.
I see that hand.
Sex is like wine, y'all.
Wow.
It gets better over time. I mean, when I tell y'all my sex life is amazing, I give God all the glory. Yeah. And I'm telling you that as a married man of 5 years who waited. Why? Guess what? You know, I can tell you, I don't have any other woman in my mind when I have sex with my wife. I'm not thinking about any other experiences. I'm not thinking about anybody else that did it like this, that did it like that. I'm only thinking about her because she's the only person that I've experienced. That is the beauty of sex done God's way. Yeah. And that's what I want each of you to experience, is the beauty of it being done God's way, of you waiting for the person that you say, this is the one I'm going to spend the rest of my life with. And when you do that, I guarantee you, that love will erupt into a sexual experience that is like nothing you've ever experienced, because guess what? That person's not gonna leave you tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So awesome. Do not go after sex for compatibility. You go after purpose, and you find the right person that you're gonna commit your life to, and I guarantee you, you'll be okay, just like Adam and Eve were.
Yeah. All right, Alec, let's talk about heartbreak and rejection.
Heartbreak and rejection.
Yeah. Really?
You asked them about sex? And you want me to talk about heartbreak and rejection?
Yes. Yes, I do. So what are some steps? Because, I mean, how many of you guys have been rejected or heartbroken? Yeah, a lot of us, if not all of us. Okay. So it's something that we all go through. What are some steps that we can take towards finding healing from heartbreak or rejection? And do any of those steps differ if you are male or female?
Okay. It's a good question. I can definitely talk about heartbreak for sure. The rejection, I think that one's really quick. I'll talk about that really quick. You guys, if you're going for a girl and she says no, you got to get over it. Like, seriously, get over it. I am proud of you for making that step and asking that girl out. Come on, I'll give it up for you men.
Yeah.
Seriously. Guys, if you get rejected, it's not the end of the world. Please do it again. I just, yeah, all right, do it. Proud of you. All right, so second thing, you were talking about heartbreak.
Yeah.
So I can really just speak from mostly experience. Actually, at one point in my life, I was engaged. And I was engaged to this very beautiful girl. She was an amazing girl. And then all of a sudden, something changed. It was heartbreaking. I mean, this is somebody who I was engaged to. I mean, when I proposed to her, it actually made the news. So it was a pretty good proposal. I'm not trying to brag. But that really added to a lot of embarrassment. Like, oh my gosh, I can't make this work. I have to break up with her, but everyone's gonna know. I'm like, I don't get the woman that I fell in love with. What am I going to do? And then when I went ahead and we finally broke it off, and she was out in Atlanta and I flew back to Colorado, I broke it off with her, and no one was at my house and I felt all alone. And I personally, I'll just tell you guys, I was on the kitchen floor and I was crying. I was just sitting there on the floor and I was crying, that I felt like I had waited my whole life for the woman of my dreams. Actually, if you guys speak about not kissing until you guys are married, I had the same thing. I was like, I'm not gonna kiss a girl until I marry my wife. And I saved my lips for this girl. And I'm like, what is that now? Like, I literally, God, I thought that you came to me and that I had a moment that you were like, because I just had this like conviction in high school. I'm like, I'm not gonna kiss a single girl until I start dating a girl seriously, and all that's gone, and all this other stuff is gone. And you guys, heartbreak is real. Heartbreak is really real, but I need to tell you what happened next on that kitchen floor. See, the thing is pain is also something that's really real. But pain is also something that's very powerful. Mm-hmm. Pain is something that connects us not only to God, but to other people. It connects us to other people so strongly that my mother and I, we both have this saying that we love saying. It's, we lead through our strengths, but we connect through our weaknesses. Mm-hmm. And it gives you an eye. It gives you the ability to talk to people who are going through pain. And when I was sitting there on the kitchen floor, I just got this beautiful imagery of God sitting down right next to me, bawling his eyes out. And it was one of the most powerful things for me. Yeah. Just feeling that somebody understands pain, that pain actually connects us to God, that God came, he gave his life on the cross so he can understand pain for whenever we're going through it. He took our pain so that he could understand what we're going through, that Jesus is the same God that wept in the Bible whenever his friend died, that he understands the heartbreak. And you guys, I just want to say, if you're going through heartbreak right now, if you have been in that area, that pain is so powerful. Take that one step closer to God, and he's going to take those 20 steps closer to you.
Can we get, yeah. Thank you for sharing. Awesome. Awesome. Yeah. You want to add something?
As Alec was talking, I thought of a memory of one of my own heartbreaks, and I feel really compelled to share that. One night, a few nights after a breakup, I was driving home from work, and it was dark out, and I started flipping through radio stations, and I landed on a Christian station. And the song that was on was Good, Good Father, which I'm sure many of you know, and there's a line in it that talks about falling deeper still into love, deeper still into love. And as I heard that line in particular, I began to weep, and I had this image of falling deeper into love. Think about a depth, and a depth is dark. When you're in the depths, it can be very dark. And in that moment, I had the sense that God was asking me after a breakup, how deep is your love for this man? How deep is your love for this man? Could your love go so deep as to let him go so that I could turn him into what I created him to be, which might not involve you? And that rocked me because I realized that like love doesn't even necessarily end with a breakup. Sometimes a breakup comes because of love. Sometimes a breakup comes because God has created you for something else that doesn't involve this relationship. And for me, as hard as it was that night to go through that, I found so much hope in thinking that there is a bigger plan and there is a reason that we go through the pain that we go through.
Yeah, it's good. It's powerful. Yeah. Round of applause. We have a couple more minutes left for our panel discussion up here. So if you guys have any questions, we're about to open the floor. So if you have something, go line up to the mic. It's going to be a couple minutes until we get to your questions. But the next one goes to Mo. So why do you think the church has made sex such a taboo topic?
Oh, we're going to dive in again. because frankly, most people within the body of Christ are dealing with the exact same sin. I think that sexual sin, especially, the enemy uses to either puff us up in pride or to silence us with shame. And by and large, I see body of Christ, which was designed to live differently, be set apart from the world in order to shift a generation, actually looking just the same as the world around it and this generation. And the shame that that brings, a part of my testimony was coming to know Christ, being set free, being in a 2-year intimacy fast. It went on 2 years, because frankly, it's just great. 40 days, oh, knock it out of the park. You'll be 3 years deep and not wanting it to end. It's worth it and it's amazing. But, you know, coming out of that, I met my now husband. And I felt like I am equipped. I am sure God has transformed me from the inside out. I know X, Y, and Z. But still, the conversations hadn't really been cultivated fully with me by way of sexuality. And so I didn't know yet the boundaries that we needed to be really intentional in setting up, the accountability we needed. And so we fell back into sexual sin. And scripture talks about the fact that it's better to have never known truth than to know truth and go back into sin. It's like a dog returning to its vomit. And I'm like, that's mildly harsh, but it feels like it. Because the weight of shame that came then
knowing truth, having been set free of so many things, and still choosing to choose for myself what I wanted over what I knew what was God's best, it was debilitating. And so I got so excited I forgot your question.
Why do you think
the church has made sex a taboo?
Yeah, there
topic?
We go.
There, we're back to it. By and large, we're struggling with the same stuff, silenced by the shame of it, and ultimately really not educated on the fullness of what God has to say about it, or the fullness and the beauty and the power of his redemption through it. And that is a big piece of the puzzle. I mean, the first conversation God ever has with man involves sex. So to talk in a healthy way about sexuality is to look more like the one who created it. All through the word, we see context of sex, the rise and fall of kingdoms even around sexual issues. And yet we have listened more to a world that's twisted it, cheapened it, perverted it, worshiped it, idolized it, and made it taboo. And we've forgotten that we have the privilege, the right, the actual invitation and responsibility to reclaim sex for the glory of God and to know truth and have him renew our minds and have him transform our hearts and have him utilize our testimonies with the blood of the Lamb being sufficient, but with the invitation for our testimonies to also defeat sin and carry power. And there's a new chapter that can come in the body of Christ where we draw a line in the sand and say, his mercies are new today, and I know he uses all for his glory. So I will boast in my weaknesses to point to the glory of the cross, and I will leverage what was dead and he brought back to life for his glory and for my good.
Yeah.
And that was winding, but I just get excited about the fact that we're actually invited to speak into this stuff, and it doesn't have to be taboo, and it doesn't have to be shameful, and it doesn't have to be kept in the darkness, because it's holy conversation.
Yeah, amen. Well, please give our panel like an amazing round of applause. I wish we had more time. Oh my gosh. All right, the floor is now open to our audience. So please come on up to the mic if you want to state your name and then ask away.
Okay, good afternoon. My name is Devin Smart. So this question is for Alec. So today I had a conversation in the office and it got real heated. The conversation was, do you believe it is acceptable to slide into someone's DMs to start a relationship?
Ooh. Slide in.
Slide into those DMs. Hey, Devin, appreciate the question. I'm not sure if this was planted by you or someone else. But anyways, I'll answer. So to slide in someone's DMs, I think that is totally okay. I actually do. There's something, but I have to give some advice to slide into the DMs. So my friends and I, we call whenever you want to pick up a girl, not in a bad way, but just to introduce yourself to a girl or to ask a girl out, we call supermanning them. So if you're Superman, right, and if you have the power of flight, and if you can fly faster than the speeding bullet, and if you fly in at the speed of sound, you're gonna kill a girl, right? If you try to fly in super quick and pick them up, so you're gonna kill them. If you fly in super slow, like, hey, here I come, and then pick them up, it's just gonna be weird, all right? So what I'm gonna say is please play to your strengths and take it slow. I understand that we're in an interesting world nowadays, but just don't freak people out. Otherwise, the cops are gonna get called on you. Devin, or whoever asked.
No, I'll add to it, because I successfully slid into the DMs.
Come on,
okay.
Man.
Oh, wait, that's
So, I met my wife. Success story.
Woo.
All right. Mark, what's up, man? Thank you so much for creating Facebook. So, I actually met my wife on Facebook, and we were complete strangers. And so, we had met through like a Facebook group. We both were part of a prayer group, and she had befriended me much years before. And I started seeing her on my newsfeed. Long story short, I'm like, who's this pretty black girl on my newsfeed? This guy talking about Jesus. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And so I went to her page, and then she had a blog. I was like, okay, so she's serious about talking about Jesus. She's blogging about it. And so I ended up just sending her a DM. just encouraging her to keep doing what she was doing. You know what I'm saying? But I had a little, you know, I was like, she ain't gonna mess this back. She's not gonna mess this back.
He's coming at the right speed. He didn't swoop in there super fast. You're gonna kill him.
And so we, so that was basically the start of it, was where I just sent her a message and just encouraging her. And then hey, I said, hey, if ever you ever need any encouragement, anything, any advice about ministry, just let me know. Nothing. And it took literally about 9 months. We became just virtual friends, you know, a little liking on Instagram. You know, it went from Facebook to Instagram. It's getting good. And it took about 9 months later that one day my pastor asked me, hey, you know, do you have anyone that you are interested in? And I was like, you know, I don't. And then I thought of Natasha. I was like, you know what? There's this girl I've been talking to on Facebook. I was like, we kind of just started this little friendship, nothing serious. And that's literally where he encouraged me to take it to the next step, right? And so whenever I went ahead and, you know, I kind of knew that we were starting to like each other, I was like, hey, I would love to get to know you better. Mm-hmm. And was very upfront. I didn't just keep playing the game, you know what I'm saying? And so, but I definitely would say, man, we are in a social media world and it's happening every single day. But just as well, ladies, I would tell you, if it's for social media, just be very careful how much attention you're giving guys in the DMs. Be very careful who you're replying back to, how fast you do it. You know, be very careful with all that stuff, because it does, guys like attention. And so you just want to kind of judge his motives, you know, immediately. And you can do that
ladies,
just by discerning.
Ladies, be like Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
Gotta leave a little wonder. All right.
Yeah.
I would think that was good. Add as a female super yes. briefly. It is quite important, the content of what is sliding into their DMs.
Right.
So an encouraging word about her ministry is going to land a lot better than a picture that makes her dry
you know
pee and drop her phone.
That's right.
So just be tactful. Wow. In
that'll preach.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
I noticed.
I went to perfect.
I noticed how the line got a lot longer.
Yeah, they it's getting real. So we're going to go ahead and.
Man, okay. All right, next question.
Awesome. Yeah, next question. Yes.
Okay, my name's Sky Stewart. So I was actually wanting to know what your guys' thoughts were on like creating lists for future spouses or even guys you're looking to date, well, girl or girls you're looking to date, you know, just what your thoughts are on that.
So I'll just throw mine out. I won't go through my list, but I'll give you the framework that I used. And I basically had my negotiables and my non-negotiables, right? So your non-negotiables are, this is absolutely what I cannot accept if the person does not have these 1, 2, 3 things, right? Love for Jesus, possibly call to ministry, whatever that those non-negotiables that you know are going to create the suitability, right? We need to know the difference between suitability and compatibility. Suitability is based around purpose. Compatibility is based around likes and desires, right? So the suitability is going to be your purpose, relationship with God, those things. And then you're going to go into compatibility, and that's your negotiable list. And you want to make sure that you are not saying no to a person based upon negotiables. Like, these are things that are like, hey, you know, she may, for me, it was like, it'd be dope if she knew how to sing. You know what I'm saying? I was like, God, that would be super cool, because when I'm preaching, she can come, you know, do my altar call, we can sing. You know what I'm saying? I had this whole world built in my mind. My wife can't sing a note, y'all. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I mean, she actually sing worse than me. I'd be like, babe, please stop. She's like, I'm just trying to be your dream woman, because I talk about it all the time. I wanted to, you know, that I want a girl who can sing. But that wasn't negotiable, you know? It wasn't a non-negotiable. So I didn't let my preference overpower my the purpose, right? And so that's what I would say for the list piece. Anybody want to?
No, that's good. That's good. Spoke a lot.
I can.
Oh, yeah.
I love that you went through negotiable versus non-negotiable, because in my ministry, I can't tell you how many times people are like, he's got to have a beard. And I'm like, does that affect his fatherhood? Does that affect how good of a husband he could be? I'm like, no. Like, you have your preferences. You have your preferences. What did he say? Did he say yeah?
Just bearded.
I mean, I guess maybe.
I was just saying, I agree with those people.
But you got your preferences and you have your standards. And, like, standards are non-negotiable, and preferences you can wax or wane on a little bit.
Awesome. Yeah. Yeah. I'll add the quickest thing to tag on to, because once again, I just will upset everybody. But there was a harsh realization for me, too, in dating with my now husband, Jeremiah, in the humbling reminder that I was not perfect.
Yeah.
I was not his dream girl, most likely. I didn't check every single box. I can be honest about my weaknesses and my struggles and my pride. And so I think sometimes, especially as women, we create this list
And we are sitting here shopping around for the perfect individual. And again, I'm talking about more of the non-negotiables, or the negotiables. But we've become this commercialized dating culture, and we want happiness. And guess what? A lifetime vow and commitment to someone is never intended to be the generating power source of your sustained happiness. The gospel of Jesus Christ and the cross of Christ is. And the idea of marriage is our closest and greatest attempt to model the gospel, which looks like being beaten down, whipped, lashed, I mean, persecuted by the shortcomings of another, and yet rising up in love and, and growing in endurance and patience. And so I think we have to loosen the grip some on this commercialized pursuit of perfection, because when happiness fades, why we see higher than a 50% divorce rate of people saying, well, you just don't do it for me anymore. And I think we have to realize we are not perfect, and also realize that there's no perfect person, but there is a perfect God who can knit us together in heart and mind and spirit, who can refine both of you through the process of relationship and marriage. And ultimately, at the end of the day, your marriage can reflect more of the goodness of the gospel than it ever did of the most Instagram likable couple, because they have a chiseled jawline and, you know, a tiny waist. It's like you're both going to get fat. The jawline and the waist goes. Everything fades. But
interruption.
Just the reality.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing. Next question.
Hi, my name is Hillary, and I have a question for Jamal, or anyone else can jump in. But nowadays, you know, there's social media and things like that. What are your thoughts on online dating, and how can you do that in a godly way, in a way that honors God, if that's even a possibility?
Absolutely. So I would say this, online dating should not be your last resort, okay? And what do I mean by that? If it's a, I've tried everything, and I don't know if I'm even attractive, you know, to anyone, I can't get anyone, I'm lonely, I'm desperate, it's now my last resort, you're going to make a very bad decision doing online dating, because now you're coming out of a place of emptiness, right? And you're looking to fill a void that a relationship cannot fill. And so I'm not going to knock online dating, because a lot of people are doing it, and it's actually successful for a lot of people. And it's just, I would say, just as unsuccessful as in-person dating can be, online dating can be. So to knock it and say it's a bad thing, there are people out here dating in person, and it's just as bad and getting just as heartbroken and messed up, you know, as people who are doing it online. And so I would definitely tell you that you definitely need to have a community of people that are going to support you. You need to have leadership that can, that will give you the peace to be able to say, yes, this is okay for you to do it. I'm going to walk with you through this process. The same thing I would encourage a person who says they're ready to enter into a dating season, where you having people there to help walk with you, you have leaders to help guide you, and you need to have that for the same thing of online dating. If you're doing it where no one else knows, then guess what? You're setting yourself up for failure, because the enemy is going to creep in and use that against you. And so we have a lot of people in our community that do try online dating, and it's been successful. And my prayer one day is to create a whole new, you know, community where we can do it the right way. Because I would tell y'all, I, as a, you know, I'm in the dating community with Golly, you know, what we do online. So I actually went one day on Christian Mingle, and I created a dummy account. Not, this is real time right now. I created a dummy account, and they shut it down like within like 7 hours. And so, but I got just enough time on there to go and just peruse, you know, and kind of go around. It was, just the conviction that I felt. And I was like, man, if this is what people are doing to get into a relationship, just doing this. I was like, this is not what God created for. And so my encouragement is just be very careful if you're going to do it. It's not a sin, but it can be done. But the reality is that you do need to have the right support doing it, so you don't make a bad decision while you're doing it.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Next question.
Hi, my name is Rachel, and this question is mainly for the ladies, simply because I'm a lady. But my question is, you know, in hymns and in worship songs, I hear a lot the term once and for all. And in purity and in my desire to surrender to purity, to surrender to Jesus, my question is this a once and for all done deal, or is it a daily surrender that you have to do? Because I've heard different viewpoints from different people.
That's good. Great question. I'll start and toss it your way. I think in all things involving our walk of faith and our pursuit of and relationship with Jesus, it is a day in, day out relationship. It is active and alive. It is coming back to the foot of the cross in repentance. It is rising up in his mercy and grace. It is seeking his wisdom. It is asking for an outpouring and indwelling of the Holy Spirit. I mean, when it comes to purity, like we were talking about, virginity is the physical marker of chastity, but purity is the heart marker, a heart that is pure. It is a condition of the heart. And heart work is hard, but holy. It is day in and day out. Yeah. And I would encourage you to continue to press in walking in that, because we need the continued help of the Holy Spirit in all things. When temptation comes, when, pain, heartbreak comes, when our wants and our emotions kind of rule. So it's hard work. It takes intentionality. But I would say it's a day in, day out process to remain pure and remain in step with the Spirit. If we live by the Spirit, let us remain in step with the Spirit is what Galatians says.
So something that I think needs to be said is that, yes, it's a daily commitment. It's a daily recommitment even. But one of the things that I've faced a lot is a lot of people say, I've already had sex, so it's too late for me. I can't practice the virtue of chastity. And I just want to make it very clear that the virtue of chastity is something you can start practicing right now. Yeah. That's like the beauty of virtue, is you don't have to have been virtuous before to be virtuous starting now. Yeah. Okay. And so a lot of times when people hear the word chastity, they think abstinence. And I just want to clarify that as well. Chastity, my favorite definition of chastity actually comes from the Catechism of the Catholic Church. A virtue, also according to the Catechism, is this decision. It's basically like a habitual and firm disposition to do good. That's what the book says. And so it's like a decision you make every day over and over to do the right thing. And sex is a sacred physical sign of the vows that we take at marriage. And so if we're going to practice a virtue that's about sex, which chastity is, it means we decide every day to do the right thing regarding sex. And you can start deciding now, even if you never have before. Yeah. And it's also important to note that all of that means that chastity is for everyone. It doesn't matter if you're single or you're married, because married people are also called to do the right thing regarding sex, which means faithfulness to the person you vowed to. Mm-hmm. And it means not using or abusing each other. It means having sex for reasons that are more substantial than just because one of us had an urge. It's not about that. And I think it's really important for everybody to go home knowing that chastity is something you can start practicing now.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Next question.
Hey, my name is Sam. Mo, I want to take a moment to say thank you for publishing your book and your story. My question is, what do you do when you're on the, it's also heartbreak, but you're on the opposite end of that and you cause that? When you do plan the proposal, plan an international trip, do that last minute, decide not to. What do you do with that? Knowing you just absolutely crush somebody.
The fact that you understand that you're dealing with someone's heart, and the fact that you have compassion for this person, even though you know that it wasn't something that wasn't right, shows that you're on the right path, man. Like, seriously, no breakup's easy. No breakup's easy. Every breakup is traumatic. And I just want to say, first and foremost, man, I commend you for just having a heart. A lot of people, they really wouldn't have a heart about it. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'd have to know more, but do you feel like you made the right decision?
Yeah, but just still, even in that being finalized, my question is about myself. What do I do knowing I didn't think I had it in the power in me to absolutely level somebody in that way?
Yeah, well.
Empty promises.
I don't know why you broke off.
Sure.
And you guys can chime in if you guys need to at all. But you have to know that if you were convicted and if you broke this for a reason, that you just said that you feel like you broke it off for good reasons, then that means that God was pressing on your heart. And I need you to know that God cares more about who you're going to marry than even you care about it. That he wants you to marry the right person more than you even do. So I know right now it's traumatic and I don't want to diminish it at all, but I want to let you know that God has someone for you. And if he broke it off, if he put that in your heart to break it off, and if you know that that was the right decision, then it's going to take some time for both of you guys to heal and let that time happen. You know, there's power in pain. Well, like I said earlier, but I'm proud of you. It's a very hard decision.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does either woman have anything to say about that?
Yeah, I would add that I think there is a lot of choices that we have to make or that we choose to make that just aren't easy. And there's a lot of choices that, in particular, the Holy Spirit may impress on our hearts. And in exercising discernment, it does not make any sense to us in the momentary. Or we can see the shock waves, the ripple effect that it will have. Or it can even we're blindsided by the impact and the power that those choices carried. But if you believe that you are exercising discernment in knowing this wasn't it, then that's a hard, hard choice. And it is hard to see the intensity with which we can affect other people. Yeah. We can truly hurt and wound others just as easily as we can be hurt and be wounded. And so it's crushing and it's hard, but if there was discernment exercising, I think it's important that we come back to a place of peace that surpasses understanding, that we come back to a place of rest, that we realize the decision was made, and that we learn from the power of how we are able to affect the hearts of others. I think it teaches us then in the future, for future relationships, God willing, how to tend to hearts more carefully, how to guard our hearts really, really carefully. Scripture says to guard the heart, it's the wellspring of life. Yeah. But how to walk, to learn from that hard time, and to grow in further discernment and also just grow in wisdom and understanding about, you know, how to tend to a heart in the future as well. But there are some decisions. I find so many people, it's like in a painful or hard choice, they then start that cycle of like coming back. We want to fix it and tend to it. Yeah. Ultimately, we need to draw near to the heart of God, and he will draw near to us. And we need to intercede and pray for that person, that God would draw near to them, to comfort them, to rebuild their heart as well, to do what he is able to do. And all of our words and all of our texts and all of our hopeful this and that can't mend, but the Holy Spirit can mend hearts. And so intercede for your former fiance. Also just draw near to him in comfort and stand firm in your discernment and your decision, because it was made.
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you. Thanks, you guys. Again for your book.
Thank you for all of your questions. I wish we had more time. Please, please give it up one more time for our panel. Seriously. You guys are amazing. Yeah. And one more time, we are encouraging you guys to go to cbn.com/unhooked to be a part of this campaign. This is an encouragement for all of you guys in your season of singleness. This is not a season of hopelessness. God wants you to thrive exactly where he's placed you. So we want to help you along that journey. So go to cbn.com/unhooked to sign up for the 40-day intimacy fast devotional and to also get this awesome journal. And we're going to also have amazing content from these people right here. I mean, I wish we had more time. They're amazing. But thank you guys so much. God bless you and have a great night.